Hello, and welcome to our Maundy Thursday service for this Holy Week 2021. We're coming to you from St. John Lutheran Church in Strasbourg, Saskatchewan. Welcome to those who are far away, and for those who have joined us from nearby. This is a solemn service and begins the great drama of the 3 days at the end of Holy Week. The conclusion of the service is traditionally very quiet, ends in silence as we prepare for Good Friday. But we begin with a confession and forgiveness, and we move into a reception of the great meal that Jesus gave for us. We turn to our confession and forgiveness. Friends in Christ, in this Lenten season, we have heard our Lord's call to struggle against sin, death, and the devil. All that keeps us from loving God and loving one another. This is the struggle to which we were called at baptism. Within the community of the church, God never wearies of forgiving sin and of giving the peace of reconciliation. On this night, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor, and enter into the celebration of the great 3 days, reconciled with God and with one another. Let us join together as we pray, most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sin. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Jesus Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, in the sharing of a meal, your Son established a new covenant for all people. And in the washing of feet, he showed us the dignity of service. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these signs of our life in faith may speak again to our hearts, feed our spirits, and refresh our bodies. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We will now hear our first reading.
The first lesson is from Exodus 12, verses 1 to 14. The Lord said to Moses and to Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of the months. It shall be the first month of your year. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of the month, and then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over a fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head and legs and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until morning. Anything that remains until morning, you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord, for I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This shall be the day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. The next reading is from Psalms 116, verses 1 to 2 and verses 12 to 19. I love the Lord because he hears me and he listens to my prayers. He listens to me every time I call him. What can I offer the Lord for his goodness to me? I will bring a wine offering to the Lord to thank him for saving me. In the assembly of all his people, I will give him what I have promised. How painful it is for the Lord when one of his peoples die. I am your servant, Lord, and I serve you just as my mother did. You have saved me from death. I will give you a sacrifice of thanksgiving and offer my prayer for you. In the assembly of all your people in the sanctuary of the temple in Jerusalem, I will give you what I have promised. Praise the Lord. And the epistle lesson is from 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23 to 26. For I have received from the Lord what I have also handed to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
We turn now to our gospel lesson. The gospel for this Maundy Thursday is taken from the Gospel of John, the 13th chapter, beginning at the first verse. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash your feet, you have no part in me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet then, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. "For this reason," he said, "not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, he put on his robe and returned to the table, and he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you should also do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." Later, when he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." So here we are, back in Holy Week. Now, how many of us expected it would be like this last year? How many were expecting instead that we would be meeting in person again by now? But here we are, loving one another still, by being careful, by wearing masks, by staying home, by maintaining 2 meters distance, by getting really, really good at washing our hands. And now, for some of us, by getting vaccinated. Last year at this service, we had our video of hand washing, if you remember. And this year, we used that same set of images a little earlier for a different service. We are in the same situation as last year in some ways, but we try to innovate and to love one another creatively. But isn't that the very eternal message of Jesus? Love one another and love God. That is the greatest commandment. And in our lives, the challenge is to do that loving creatively and spontaneously from the heart. And we also love one another as a practice, as ritual, and as a challenge, and as a defiance to the ways of our world. Our Western culture, in particular, has an almost rabid focus on independence and personal liberty. And it's so individualistic, it actually undermines its own message. Because when we love ourselves to the exclusion of caring for others, we are left alone, isolated, little fragments of loneliness floating through a hostile void. Jesus did not say, "Love your neighbor and hate yourself." Neither did he say, "Love yourself and who cares about your neighbor." There is a cultural imperative in the Western world that says that to be totally focused on others, well, on one hand, is the perfect ideal, and on the other hand, is completely useless. So we get this mixed message. The fact is, when we love our neighbor as ourself, we will automatically find the balance. When we love our neighbors as ourselves, then we have the power and the feedback loop of encouragement that enables us to love them and ourselves in our serving and caring. By serving one another, we are then built up in love and rooted in mutual respect and care. And in a very real sense, we become more able to love ourselves as we love one another. Also, we learn to love each other as we are then empowered to better take care of and love ourselves, the gift that we are from God for each other. We have been going through a wonderful book lately on shadow work. I don't know, some of you may have heard that term, but it is a psychological term, I believe, coined initially by Carl Jung, who speaks of a shadow side of our personality. For every one of our facets of our personality, there's a dark side. Strength and a power of character and determination can also have the dark side of running roughshod of other people and being domineering. Being selfless and giving can have the dark side of having a martyr personality that resents not being appreciated. For every positive, there is a dark side that we have to be aware of. And for every one of our perceived faults, there is a gift buried in there. There's a fear in many of us as we were raised of being seen as being selfish. And so we try to do everything for everybody else and leave ourselves back in the dust and don't care for ourselves. This too is dysfunctional, because when we destroy ourselves in the name of helping others, we have nothing to give. There's a shadow to every piece of light, and there's light that creates every shadow. When we learn to live our own disowned shadow parts that we like to deny and find the gift that's in them, then we can learn to have more compassion for the shadow side that shows up so more quickly to us, so much more quickly than our own in other people. It can give us the ability to have more compassion for the flaws and faults of others when we're able to own our own flaws and faults. And then a real compassion and a real love can bloom. So as one's called to love one another, as we love ourselves, we are called to serve one another, to, in the great image, wash each other's feet. Take the role of the lowly servant. And in our world, wash our hands to protect one another from whatever we may be carrying, whether that's COVID or some other infection. It's a good habit. Maybe we've gotten over a year to practice that, and maybe that'll stick. And that will be a benefit to everybody. We are called in our serving to be humble, but not humiliated. And in that mutual loving and serving, true compassion can bloom. And when true compassion, love, and service define our lives among each other and to the world and to ourselves. Truly, Christ is made visible in that love. Love one another. Serve one another. Washing feet, washing hands, cleansing our world of the things that we see that are destructive or dangerous for one another. And Christ stands among us when we do that. Amen. Our hymn is number 496, One Bread, One Body.
We
Peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us pray for new life in the church, new hope for the world, and God's love for all who are in need. We give you thanks for the giving of this meal that draws us together as your people around one table throughout all space and time. That you come to us still, as you did in that night in the upper room, is a miracle and a glory. And it is our unity. May we ever come together in respect for one another and in honor of what you have done, are doing, and will do among your people throughout all generations. May we honor each other and honor ourselves as you have honored us by inviting us to join with you at your table. We ask for mercy, encouragement, strength, new hope, and relief for all those who suffer. We are aware that we are so privileged here in this place and at this time that we have been blessed so richly. May we not take those blessings for granted, but use them to bless those who have less, that all may rejoice in your abundance. We join together in remembrance, and more, in a commitment to follow you in your footsteps of care, grace, and love. We give you thanks for those who've gone before us, for the saints, for their presence with you, and the promise that we shall join them as we walk faithfully to the end of our days. We pray to you, O God, in the name of the one who endured the cross, who forgives our sin, who feeds us at his table, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Greet one another with a sign of peace. At this time, if you have not prepared communion elements at home, please feel free to pause the recording and join with us. All who wish to receive the gift of Christ's presence in the bread and the wine are welcome to join with us. This is the table of Christ, who has called us to be one in his presence. Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Christ Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, whose suffering and death gave salvation to all. You gather your people around the tree of the cross, transforming death into life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We join in the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now, send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world through the rest of this great drama, and bring the hope that you bring through it to all around. May we continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.